We're not actors or TV personalities. We're just a couple of guys who want to show you how to restore your car. Sometimes we mess up. Sometimes we consult the pros. It's never a problem. It's always a project.
Up next on Autorestomod, Vinny gets loose, Jeff gets on board a 67 Mustang, a 69 Fairlane, and an 05 Crown Vic to talk nice. Rats? I don't get paid enough for this.
Order a bunch of parts to get ready for the car show this weekend.
And I got a hot deal, too.
You think? Think again.
Oh, man.
Tired of back orders? You need NPD. With four strategically located superstores, orders are shipped direct to your door within 1 to 3 business days. National Parts Depot has quality restoration parts for Ford truck, Mustang, Camaro, Chevelle, and Firebird. For your free catalog, visit NPD online or call toll free.
So we've been mucking around with our 351 Cleveland and our 69 Fairlane wagon for a little while, and I kind of wanted to go out and show you a little bit of what she's capable of. Up front, we've got the 351 Cleveland that I just mentioned. We've got Aussie 2V closed chamber heads on it, 9.5:1 compression ratio, a mild RV crane cam, Harlan Shop roller rockers, stock exhaust manifold, dual exhaust with Flowmaster. The carburetor is an Autolite 4100, and it's the 108 Venturi carburetor. We're also running 46 main jets, a 7.5 power valve, and our secondary jets are 67s. And we're running a C4 automatic behind that with a 300 rear gear. So, we're gonna go out, do a little experimentation, let's say, and show you what she's got in her. No way that we would be able to tell a cop that we were braking. There's just no way. Because of all the smoke in here. All right, well this week we've got a 67 Mustang hardtop from a viewer that we're going to be doing a rack and pinion install in next week. Now what I wanted to do with this week is I actually wanted to kind of go over why we're doing a rack and pinion in this car. And I wanted to go over some of the things that are misconceptions about the power assist systems in these classic Mustangs and pretty much anything Ford from the 1960s. Most of the Ford products from the midsize on down used a power assist rather than actually using an integral steering box. Integral didn't actually enter the picture for the Mustang and even the Torinos until 1971 for the Mustang and 1972 for the Torino. And the integral systems are a lot better. I like those because everything's tied into the box. This is literally an assist system on this car. This car has power assist and a box that is sloppy enough that I can literally do this and not get a whole lot of motion out of it. Now the problem that creates is a sloppy box with power steering is a really light steering feel. You'll go down the road and you'll feel like you're doing just fine. You got the wheel all centered up. You want to make a minor correction. And as you're turning the wheel, you never quite know when the box is going to come back into play. That can be a real issue. Now, one of the main problems is the power assist itself. A lot of guys say it lacks road feel. I don't necessarily agree with that. The car has road feel coming back through the box, but the problem is the power assist is so light, I can literally operate this car with one finger. Not the safest thing in the world to do probably, but it gives you an idea of just exactly how light the power assist systems were in these original cars. And this system is no different than any other one I've ever driven. They're all very light underhand, and that's pretty darn normal for these cars. Now Jim actually wants to go in and put a rack and pinion with power on it in this car. I think it's a good idea. Unisteer makes a nice example. We're going to be installing that next week. But what I wanted to go over this week is some of the things that you'll run into with both power assisted systems like this car and the manual steering like we have in our 69 Fairlane and even a modern rack and pinion that's a car that is a conversion. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to go back, get the Fairlane, show you how that works. Okay, so now we're in our 69 Fairlane. We've got a manual steering box in this thing. This is a 69 box. It's what Ford originally put in there. So it's you get what you're gonna get. The guy who had this car before us, when he built it, he put a brand new steering box in here, and that is a really good thing for us for right now. And what we're eventually gonna do with this car is we're going to go in and install a 1969 power steering box and power valve and assembly on here like the 67 Mustang has, so that we have power steering. And the reason I want to do that is kind of what I talked about with the 67. It's like when Carla drives this car, my wife, I want her to be able to enjoy driving the car from the aspect that she's not having to grunt like I have had to do turning this thing. These things are heavy underhand. I'll give you a little bit of an example right here. Now, we shot this while we were doing some turning around sequences, trying to get the car going in a different direction. Now, we're turning around to go back to shoot some more. And this is what I'm talking about with manual steering. This is really a big pain in the rear because you got to muscle it around and it doesn't turn very easily. So you fight this thing the entire time you're driving it. So it's a little harder to drive than some of the other stuff we've got. Now that's what you get. That's what you get whenever you're working with a manual steering box. You get a box that's actually a little heavy underhand. It's kind of a pain in the butt when you're in parking spots, trying to park the car. Those kind of things will just rip you up. The nice thing is you'll end up getting a really good tight movement out of it. The car will respond really nicely underhand, but it's just a bear to drive on a daily basis. I don't like them for that instance. I don't like the fact that you get beat up by driving a thing. And yes, it's really good if you want huge guns on you, but otherwise, I'm not that crazy about them. So, what we're gonna do now is we're gonna take our Vic to show you what it is to have a nice rack and pinion in your car. Okay, so why a 2005 Crown Vic? Well, the simple reason for that is this is actually a retrofit car. This car was originally built with a worm insector or recirculating ball steering system, and Ford actually retrofitted the chassis in 2005 to run a rack and pinion. So with this being a retrofit rack from Ford Motor Company, you can figure that they did their homework and set everything up the way it needed to be. And I'm real happy with it. I've had this thing all the way up to what I like to call ludicrous speed, and it runs out really nice, no weirdness to it at all. So I don't have a problem with putting a rack and pinion in my cars. So what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna go back to the shop and talk to you a little bit about rack and pinions and what you can expect to run into when you're working on a car, putting one in.
Oh, hey Jeff, how'd the driving test go?
It went pretty well, man. It's really amazing to me when you'll do that back to back, where you take a car, and you drive another car, and then you drive another car. And it's like going night and day between that 67 and the Crown Vic, which has a rack and pinion in it. Totally different driving experience than that old car. So yeah, it went pretty well, but like I said, it definitely shows the shortfalls of that, you know, that whole recirculating ball system, like on that steering box right here in front of us.
Yeah, so you're gonna put this yellow rack in the black 67?
No,
it's gonna look like a yellow jacket, man. You're gonna repaint that for him?
Yes. No, this is a sample rack that the guys at Unisteer sent to us so that we could actually show what the real operation of a rack and pinion is. Take some of the mystery out of it, and that's kind of what I wanted to go into now. Let's talk about the difference between a recirculating ball system and a rack and pinion system. Now, basically, rack and pinion is just that. It is a rack, this is your rack, and this is your pinion. That's really the basis of everything, and it's a direct feed. So in other words, if you take this and you move this, this would be connected directly to your steering column and your steering wheel, and it's a direct feed down to the rack itself.
Right, you've got a gear down here that directly engages these teeth on the rack, direct steering.
And it's really direct steering because this goes directly out to the two tie rod ends on either side of the rack and pinion, so you're not getting any kind of lost motion in it at all. Not so when you're talking about a recirculating ball.
Speaking of lost motion, now this box is a little tired, and there's a really dead spot right there.
There was a hard spot on this one. Now, this was actually the steering box that was in our 1967 Fastback. And there is a real hard spot on the center telling me that this box is probably completely worn out. Now, there's a screw on the very top of the steering box with a nut on it. And that screw has a slot in it. Now, what people will do is they'll take this and they'll go in and screw that in until everything feels nice and tight. What they're actually doing is changing the position of this central shaft here, and there's a ball in there, and they're just putting more tension on that ball. And
when
they're
right.
And it's not good.
But even in its prime, so you would just have a pitman arm hanging at the end of that, so you've got a little bit of slop in the box itself, and then you've got idler arm, then you got your inner tie rods, then you got your outer tie rods, and every one of those joints adds a little bit of slop and a little bit of play. So it just doesn't feel
and even
quite as nice
after it gets
going
older.
On the road.
Right. And then when you add a power assist system to it, you have even more play in the system.
Right.
And that's why you get that vague feeling out of it. You know, people will talk about getting better road feel out of a car with a rack and pinion. Honestly, I don't think the road feel is that much different with the power assist, other than the fact that it's just a lot tighter feeling with something like a rack and pinion, because when you turn the wheel, it's going to go. And that's something we kind of want to address here too. Depending on what you want to do with the car, rack and pinions are great. I like them for a lot of different applications. They're going to add a very sporty feeling to the car that you're not going to get with a standard box type system where you're using all those lost motion links. So if you're going for a straight up driver that you're just going to be going down to the store in, you know, a rack and pinion may not be the right choice for you. If you're wanting your car to be a real sporty, razor sharp handling car and you're going to be doing a lot of performance driving with it, I really think a rack and pinion is a good solution to the problem. All right, now what I think I want to do is we're going to go over to the 67 and kind of start looking at what we're going to be running into, because we've got a couple of issues.
Always. Got to do something before we can do something.
Well, of course.
Always.
I mean, we're not going to get to the disassembly this week, but we want to show you some of the things that we're going to probably be talking to the guys at Unisteer about in regard to some of the specialty items that Jim Collison's car has on it. Let's go ahead and go and take a look at it.
All right, Jeff. I know these steering boxes get some play in them, but surely you exaggerated in how bad this one is. Oh, my God.
You hear that?
I can hear it, but I also see, look at how much the steering wheel's moving and the tires are just perfectly still. That's awful.
I know. It's a good thing Collison brought the car to us when he did. I mean, this thing is in horrible shape.
Steering-wise. I mean, other than that, it's a nice
looking car. I'm not talking about the car or anything. But the other thing I'm a little concerned about is, as you notice, it has tilt wheel in it. And it's...
Did notice that.
It's honestly a 67 tilt-away car. In other words, it came from the factory with tilt-away steering, which can be a good thing or maybe a bad thing. We're going to have to get with the guys at Unisteer and go over that, because I wasn't aware that the car was a tilt-away when we said we were going to do this. Not that it's a problem, but I want to make sure when we do this that we don't run into something right in the middle of doing the assembly.
Right.
So I want to go in and actually talk to them. I have a feeling that this is actually going to be probably easier than doing a standard box, because the standard box column is longer.
Mm-hmm.
Goes almost all the way down to the steering box itself.
Right, right.
Now, our 67 Fastback has a tilt-away, and I've rebuilt that tilt-away, and it actually has double Ds in it. Not those, but double Ds.
Oh.
It's just like right in the ditch. In any case.
You're the one talking dirty.
I'm not talking dirty. I'm talking mechanical. In any case, this car possibly has a double D shaft assembly in it, which will make it easier to set up with the universals that they use to get down to the rack and pinion. But I want to make sure about that before we go into it and start doing the disassembly. So we're going to have to get with those guys, and we'll do that during the week this next week.
Oh, yeah. Sorry, I was still thinking about double Ds.
All right, folks, that's our show for this week. Thank God. Next week, we are going to be coming back with the disassembly of this system and possibly getting started on the installation of the Unisteer rack that we've got here. So do us a favor and come back and watch us next week on
Autorestomod.
You with the sexual comments.
You're the one that made the comments.